You ready? I'll read. Is everybody having fun at the Revel? Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On April 3rd, 1948, 37 years ago, the very first performance of the Louisiana Hayride took place in a municipal auditorium in Shreveport, Louisiana. In the next 10 years, that show was to develop to national prominence, more artists than all the other shows in country music history combined, including the Grand Ole Opry. They don't actually develop artists at the Opry. They go there after they're famous. Actually, KWKH had had a Saturday night show before World War II. It was in the Municipal Auditorium, and it featured such people as the Arizona Ranch Girls and Bob and Joe Shelton and the Delmore Brothers and Wayne Rainey and Hoke and Paul Rice and many others. It had closed down because most of the guys had gone into the service, including me. But in 1948, I was back with KWKH, and we had a lot of acts appearing on the radio station. And we convinced them that we should start a Saturday night show for promotion of the acts and for publicity for the station. The very first performance of the Louisiana Hayride, April 3rd, 1948, included the Bales Brothers, Johnny and Jack and the Tennessee Mountain Boys, featuring Miss Kitty Wells, the Four Deacons, Curly Kinsey and the Tennessee Ridge Runners, Harvey Smith and the Ozark Mountaineers, Happy Covington's Band, the Mercer Brothers, Tex Grimsley and the Texas Playboys. I was the MC and I was assisted by Ray Bartley. And we started that first show just as we start this reunion of some former members of the Louisiana Hayride tonight by saying, the Louisiana Hayride. Appeared on the Louisiana Hayride, who did appear the first 10 years on the original Hayride, we'd have probably 500 different people. Because that show developed into prominence an incredible number of people. Later on in the evening, I'm going to name most of them. Here are just a few that became famous on the show. Hank Williams, Webb Pierce, Slim Whitman, Farron Young, Jim Reeves, Kitty Wells, Johnny and Jack, George Jones, Bob Luman, Jonny Horton, and a guy that's going to be our special guest a little bit later on tonight. I'll tell you his name when we get to it. The very first band that I recall at all playing the very first number on the Louisiana Hayride was a group called Tex Grimsley and the Texas Playboys. Now, he moved from Texas to Louisiana, and he's been our state champion fiddler for many, many years. Here he is, the original Louisiana Hayride member, Tex Grimsley, in person.
Thank you so much, friends and neighbors. Thank you. Somebody said, how long have you been playing the fiddle, Tex? I said, so long until the shadow of my elbow wore a hole through the floor. Gonna kick it off with Black Mountain Breakdown, just like we did on April 3rd, 1948, at the Louisiana Hayride with Horace Logan emceeing, and it goes like this. Thank you. Charles tune. This one here is tune standard. We fixing to do a little tune here, and one that we did on the Hayride also, one of the Bob Wills numbers, called A String Blues in the Key of A, and it goes like this. Here's going to be a tune that me and my brother Cliff Grimsley wrote years ago for Webb Pierce. It's called Walking the Dog, and it's in the key of G, and it goes like this. Yeah.
can still go a little heated. Tonight, you're going to meet all these guys one at a time. I'm not going to introduce them all at once. But I would like you to meet the original piano player and one who was with us through the entire length of the Louisiana Hayride, Sonny Harville, in person. Now, we had another piano player on the show for quite a long time. Turned out to do pretty good for himself, a youngster named Floyd Kramer. Some of you, I'm sure, have heard of him. Yes. Then we had a guy come up one day and ask me for a job. He wanted to join the Hayride. And he said he was a piano player. I said, look, man, we don't need but two, and we've got them. We got two great ones. He said, who are they? I said, Sonny Harville, Floyd Kramer. He said, never heard of them. He said, you will. Hang around, you will. He didn't tell me at all that he could sing. His name turned out to be Jerry Lee Lewis. Every time I see him, he rhymes. He said, you didn't hire me. I said, you didn't tell me you could sing. Down through the years, so many people came to the Hayride, unknown, and left nationally and internationally known. A list of about 35. I have suggested to the City Council of Shreveport that we take the wings of the old municipal auditorium and convert them into a Louisiana Hayride Hall of Fame. Yeah. I think we should do it. That building is unprecedented. There's no other building like that in the world. More people have become famous in that building than in any other building in the world anywhere. The list is unreal. Some other people that became famous on the show. Well, the Browns, G.E. Brown and his group, Floyd Kramer, Jimmy Newman, Maddox Brothers and Rose, Red Sovine, Billy Walker, Mitch Torok, the Carlisles, Zeke Clements, Goldie Hill, Sonny James, Claude King, and many, many more, which I'll be naming later on in the evening. We had two separate kinds of bands on the Hayride, the old original Hayride. We had a hillbilly band. I mean, it was hillbilly. There was no question about it. And it, which one of you two did that feature, you two steel men? Now, both of them are going to deny it. If ever there was any country boys, you have them. One of them played in the Uptown Band, kind of semi-pop, by those days' standards. That was Felton. And the funny-looking one, I mean, the good-looking one on the corner down there in the end, Sonny Trammel played in the other. Buddy Attaway, rest his soul, was in one of those bands. Jimmy Dave was in them, Floyd Kramer, and lots of other people down through the years. But these two guys, we called them the Lump Lump Boys. That's because they were. And they have been, were with the show through its entire duration, 10 years in length. It operated without any interruption. We now call them the Dynamic Steel Duo. Felton Pruett, Sonny Trammel, right here.
Thank you.
hooded guitarist in a pink shirt is that's been stepping up here from time to time. He is just one of the very best in the entire cotton picking world. His name is James Burton. He started off right here in Shreveport, Bossier City area. The first record he made was with a fellow named Dale Hawkins. That wasn't really Dale's name, but he changed his name to Dale Hawkins in order to have a name that was easy to remember. Everybody's trying to do that, you know, trying to get some name that'll stick in your mind. This guy had the best stage name in the history of names and changed it to Dale Hawkins. His real name is Delmar Diffie. Now, you'll remember that. I bet you a year from now, I walk up and say, what was that guy's name? You'll say, Delmar Diffie. That's the whole idea to remember. The first song that James ever recorded was a thing called Susie Q. Yes, that's right, absolutely. Oh, you remember. Right. Absolutely. Later on tonight, we're going to get James on stage by himself practically here and have him show you some of his guitar wizardry, because down through the years, he's recorded with literally hundreds of people. Some little second-rate artists like Sinatra, some fellow named Presley, Elvis Presley, that's it, yes, a whole lot of records with him. Now, with just about everybody of importance in the musical field, this young man's fertile mind and ability as a guitar player has really improved and enhanced their records. You'll be hearing him tonight. We think he's great. One of the first guys to ever be on the Louisiana Hayride was a fellow that's so young we didn't know whether to put him on stage to send him back to school. Little baby-faced fella that played a stand-up bass that was tall as he was. His name was Don Davis. Well, friends, this is 37 years later, and he's still a little baby-faced fella. Where is he? Right back. Absolutely. The first artist to gain national prominence on the Louisiana Hayrides was a fellow named Hank Williams. He came to the show from Montgomery, Alabama. Actually, when we started announcing nationally in magazines that we were going to start the Louisiana Hayride, Hank called me at the radio station, and he wanted to know if he could get on the show. Well, at that time, he was living in Montgomery, Alabama, his hometown, and he was working a daily radio program, and he already had a reputation as a drunk. I hate to say that, but Hank was an alcoholic, and he couldn't tolerate it. I told him if he'd stay sober for 6 months and prove it, then he could be on the hayride. And every week, he would call me from the radio station, get the manager on the phone, and they'd say, yeah, he's been sober, he's been fine. So at the end of 6 months, I told him to come on, and he drove into town, down in front of the old building, down on Texas Market, in an old Chrysler with everything he had on top of it. He had the mattress and the springs and everything tied up there, and inside he had his wife and her daughter by a former marriage. That was Miss Audrey. And he came walking in and said, I'm Hank Williams and I'm ready to go on. So we put him on that Saturday night. And within about 5 months' time, with a song called Lovesick Blues, he was probably the most popular single country music artist in the United States. He left the show after many months, went up to Nashville, stayed for several years, came back to the show, and was a member of the Hayride at the time of his very untimely death. That was the first artist to gain fame on the Hayride. The last one to gain fame on the Hayride is with us tonight. And I mean one of the best ones, too. Let's welcome to the show, Nat Stuckey.
Thank you very much, Horace. It's great to be back in Shreveport. This is where it all started for us. It's great to be back. The only thing about fronting a portion of this show is that you have to turn your back on these guys. Yeah. But we ain't gonna worry about that. Everybody get in here, ready? One, two, three, four.
Well, a country boy named Shorty and a city boy named Dave had proved to run fastest to win Miss Lucy's hand. But the daddy had all that money, also had the looks, but Shorty must have had some boy the game he found in books. I say cut across, Shorty, Shorty, cut across, that's what Miss Lucy said. Cut across, Shorty, Shorty, cut across, it's you I want to win. But my dad with his long big smile left Shorty far behind, but Shorty could hear him call, Miss Lucy was had fixed the race.
Experience that nobody down here drinks beer. When we were growing up in Northeast Texas, a little town called Atlanta, which is only about 55, 60 miles from here, I think the three most important things in my life was drinking beer, chasing girls, and playing football. And it still ain't bad. But being on the road a whole bunch, I don't have a lot of time to play football anymore. But we did write a song about beer drinking, which we included on our first album that we did for Paula Records out of Shreveport here, over in Tyler, Texas, at Robin Hood Bryan's studio. And we had a song out called Sweet Thing, and we were planning on releasing this song that I'm going to do now as our second single, and Jim Ed Brown beat us to it. So if anybody's got one under the chair there somewhere, let's pop a top, okay?
Some other fools.
Largely, as I said, we our first hit song came while we were still working for KWKH Radio here in Shreveport, performing regularly on the Louisiana Hayride. And it's with mixed emotions that I come back down here because I hadn't seen some of these people in a long, long time. I've worked with James out in L.A. He played guitar on an album that we were doing out there. And seen some of the other people occasionally and heard from them, but it's the first time in a long time that I've had an opportunity to visit with them. Sit down and have a beer and smoke a cigarette and talk about old times. And it's been great to see some of you folks that I haven't seen for a long, long time either. Because deep in my heart, I know that you folks right here in Shreveport, Louisiana, were responsible for me getting started and making it possible for me to do something that I've wanted to do all my life. And I still enjoy doing it. And the song that got it all started for us. I slipped out of the house about sundown. My mama was the one in her head. You bet your bottom dollar she'll come looking for me when she finds that I'm not there. And if she catches this sweet thing running around, I know there'll be the devil to pay. She'll come blowing like a siren.
More so for you. Isn't he great? You know, he was a radio announcer on KWKH, and he kind of got into singing on the back door. That's what he had in mind, really, from the beginning. But he started by being an announcer. So did Jim Reeves do the same thing. Was an announcer on KWKH and worked on the Louisiana Hayride as one of the MCs and gradually evolved into being a really great singer. Well, let's see. Who else came off the Hayride? Charlie Monroe, Leon Payne, Harmy Smith, Tommy Trent, T-Texas Tyler, the Wilbon family, Mac Wiseman, Johnny Cash, Lefty Frizzell, Tommy Sand, and a young fellow that Slim Whitman told me about one day. Slim used to stutter pretty bad, and he came in the office and he said, I put a ball on the shelf in Memphis, and he stole it away from me. I said, you ought to get him down here. I said, what is his name? He said, I don't know, some funny name. Well, about a week later, I guess it was, a couple of our disc jockeys at the time, Frank Page and Norm Bale, had been up to Memphis to start studying television. And they came back and told me about a kid up in Memphis is really tearing him up. I said, what's his name? They didn't know his name. And a day or so later, Tillman Frank brought me a record of a guy named Elvis Presley. And I listened to him, and I said, is that the one that Slim put on his show up in Memphis? Yep. I better get him down here. So I had my secretary call Memphis. There wasn't any such label as a Sun record label that he was on. We called a disc jockey at WMPS Radio, and he said, that is Sam Phillips' record shop. We called a record shop and said, yep, we've got him. I said, I'd like to have him down on the hayride. When do you want him? This Saturday. I said, well, he can't come in this Saturday. He's going to go over and try to get on the Grand Ole Opry. And that was the famous night that Jim Denny told him that he ought to go back to driving a truck, and he cried all the way back to Memphis. Well, the next week, he came down to the hayride. He had two men with him, Scotty Moore and Bill Black. I paid him $75 for the three of them to come down. He called me at home in the afternoon, wanted to rehearse. I'd never heard of that. A country music musician rehearsing? Something wrong with it. But I went down to the auditorium with him, and I watched him. He had on pink pants. Had on one of them loose kind of shiny shirts, and he wiggled. I said, man, this ain't country, but it is something else, I'm telling you. That night, we had a coast-to-coast CBS radio broadcast, 190 stations, and I put him on it. And I told those people, you will be able to tell your children and grandchildren that you saw the very first network performance of a young man named Elvis Presley, who's going to set a new style of music. And he did. He sure did. Next week, I invited him back. He brought his mom and papa with him because he was underage. He was 19. And he signed a contract to appear on the Louisiana Hayride every Saturday night for a year. I was very generous with him. I gave him union scale. Elvis got $18, Scotty got $12, and Bill got $12. That wasn't bad money in 1954. Wasn't bad at all. Ain't bad for some of these guys today. After he'd been on the show for a year, by then he was one of the most popular artists in the entire world, and I raised him to the magnificent figure of $200. And at that time, he could afford to hire a drummer named DJ Fontana. And we got him right here tonight. There he is. That's Elvis Presley's original drummer. You've heard him on thousands of records, not only on those of Elvis, but DJ is one of those studio musicians. They are hard to find. That's the good musicians. They don't have to travel all over the country. They can stay there in the studio and take the money away from them. He has been on literally hundreds of records, as has James Burton and a lot of the other guys that are in here tonight. Speaking of James Burton, we're going to get him forward and get him to do a little of his unusual guitar style for him. You've actually heard him thousands of records. We're not necessarily aware of it.
Of course, I had a request to help me make it through the night.
Hey, that's a good one.
Let's try.
All right, let's hear James Burton himself.
Thank you.
I've had in the past, the 10 years that the Hayride operated, an incredible number of musicians. One team that comes to mind, Hoot and Curly, had a very unique and unusual style. They accompanied Slim Whitman on most of Slim's songs, and I think they kind of developed that style by accident, because I believe one of them started trying to imitate Slim's high-pitched voice. Sonny, either one of you felt to know how who played that steel guitar a little bit? Let's hear just a little bit of the way Hoot and Curly used to play. Yeah, that was about it, yeah. Hoot said you didn't have to be good to play that way, just had to have a lot of nerve. But it worked very well, because Slim had 3 million-selling records in the early 1950s while he was on the Louisiana Hayride. Whenever the show started dragging a little bit and we decided we needed to amp it up a little bit, we'd always get all the gang together and say, let's have us a good old-fashioned, everybody play some solo bits, some kind of a breakdown. And I think that's a pretty good idea to roll one in here right now. Give us a good short, fast one with everybody being featured.
Thank you.
did the hayrides close? I'm going to tell you exactly why. The hayride was owned by a family which also owned KWKH, the Shreveport Times, some other radio stations and TV stations across the South. And the hayride was just one facet of many things that this organization was doing. We never did set up, and I never was allowed enough money to set up a booking agency. Once an artist has become famous all over the world, obviously they can make money, and obviously they need to book all over the world. We didn't have the facilities for that. They had them in Nashville. All of the booking agencies were in Nashville. And when Hank Williams became famous, it was not morally right to keep him here when we were unable to book him properly, so we let him go. He went up to Nashville, started booking, traveling all over the world, everywhere. We found to our delight that as soon as the major star left, another one of our artists was elevated to be the top star. The second one was Webb Pierce. After Webb Pierce was Lynn Whitman. After that was Farron Young. And then the list is absolutely endless. It's a tremendous number of them. So the hayride stopped simply because it had finally reached a point to where if the booking agencies were not set up, they were not booked properly, we couldn't continue. And that's exactly what happened. That's why it died. Not the fault of Elvis or anybody else. It was just a fault of, shall I say it, lack of foresight on the part of the owners. I got mad, quit, and left. When I left, I took Bob Luman and, who's the principal guy? I took James Burton, James Kirkland, Butch White, Fred Carter, David Houston, all with me. We went out to California and went to work on shows out there. We had a great time. But before I left, I did one great final thing. I think it was great. I hired one man on the hayride. The very last one that I put on the Louisiana hayride was a fellow by the name of Van Givens, and he's coming on stage for you now. Now, you may not know Van Givens too well, but I guarantee you one thing. You know some of the songs he's written, because he is one of the finest country songwriters in existence. He's going to do a few of them for you now. Let's welcome Van Givens to the hayride.
Thank you, Horace. We appreciate it. First off, I would like to make a request to the sound man and the musicians. Could you crank their monitor up just a tad for them? Because they're, yeah, up just a tad. Because I always play softly, Horace. Oh, all right. Everybody plays softly. Okay, they know. Horace was mentioning something that was really, really got to me. Because he mentioned, you know, people wanting to go pop with their records. Now, when I was on the Louisiana Hayride, Carl Ballou, who I wrote with for some 30 years, had an expression, Horace. He used to say that man couldn't go pop with a mouthful of firecrackers. And that fitted a lot of us. We found our place. We used to have a terrific argument. I told this story last night. What I'm going to do at my part, for the songwriters or the would-be songwriters in the crowd, they've asked me to tell a couple of stories about songs, so I'm going to do that. We used to have a sort of an argument going on the hayride when Elvis Presley came to the hayride and somebody had to follow Elvis Presley on stage. It was chaos. You were a nervous wreck till you went up and found out who Horace had scheduled after Elvis Presley. But it was horrible to go out there on 50,000 beautiful watts and be trying to sing your new Victor record. And they're saying, we want Elvis, we want Elvis.
That's the way it was.
And that's the way it was. But Elvis was a gentleman. I have a picture among my souvenirs, Horace, of the night that Elvis walked out and took his white coat off and draped it over my shoulders and said, listen to him, he's got a good song.
That's right, he did.
He was a gentleman and he was a scholar. All right, we were having just such an argument one night backstage because it was between Carl Ballou and I who was going to follow Presley. Presley was on stage doing a May Axton Boren tune. Maybe some of you remember it. Burton's played it a million times. Remember this, Burton? Well, since my baby left me, I found a new place to dwell. It's down at the end of Lonely Street at the Heartbreak Hotel. The only thing I could think of was World War III or getting a peg-legged veteran to wave the flag or maybe getting a kid out on the show. Carl Ballou, bless his heart, was sitting over there with his guitar, and he looked at me and said, Vandal? I said, what? He said, where's this place called Lonely Street? I said, hey, Carl, that's a good idea, man. I said, let's write that. So we did, and it goes like this. I'm looking for that lonely street. I've got a brand new taste. I need a place to go and where's this place all lonely street? Where there's just one where there might spring forgetfulness, where broken dreams and memories, where is this place called Lonely Street? Where is this place called Lonely Street? Story of one song. Let me give you a story of another song. The reason I'm so proud of these songs is because Carl Blue and I got awards for them. They're called Billionaires. That means that they've been played over 1 billion times on the radio station. And we got the first two awards, Horace, on those two songs, along with Release Me was another song that got it. Eddie Miller was with us, and we were real proud of it because, you know, that's a highlight in somebody's life. All right, let me take you up to a place in Kansas. In those days, we worked for $25, and Horace knows this to be true. When we get, wait a minute, I said 25. That was counting the room.
15.
In those days, when you done a show for the club owner, during intermission, you didn't go back and rest on the bus. What you did was go around and take these little pictures that you had printed up for a penny a piece, and you signed them and said, oh, it's good to have you out here tonight. What would you like to hear? This was the thing that you had to do. Because if you were popular and somebody accidentally told the club owner, hey, I'd like to have them back, you got $20 the next time. That was it. So we were walking around. Back in those days, I had a stock expression I'd use. You know, hello, honey, you look like your dad give your dog away. What's wrong with you? Carl Blue and I were circulating, signing pictures. We saw these two ladies sitting down. We sat down by them. Hi, how are you? We're glad to have you here tonight. What would you like to hear? This one lady is sitting by Carl, looked right over my shoulder, and she never said a word to me. And I tried to carry on the conversation. Finally, she said, look at him. I said, hon, look at who? She said, look at that man over there at that door. She said, I was married to him for 8 years. Said, last night, for no reason at all, said he come on, told me it was over. He was leaving me. He didn't need me anymore. She said, he knows I'm here tonight because I couldn't stay away from him any longer. And she looked at me and a little bit of tear run out of her eye. And she said, tell me something. Am I that easy to forget? 10 minutes later, the song was born. You say you found somebody new. Won't stop my loving you. How can you turn and walk away? Forget the love I have for you. Yes, I could find somebody too. You find you what is love.
Bible. Jim Reeves honored us by doing this song. I love you forever. And if you must go, I live with my memory of your love's tender tone. You never would leave.
I've had 16 number one records, and I've had 323 songs recorded.
Yes, a song that you've written, right. One of my favorites is the weirdest thing that you ever heard in your whole life. He's going to do a little bit of it for you right now. Written by Mr. Gibbons himself.
All right, thank you, Horace. I want to tell you something. My original band consisted of James Burton. I was the first dude he ever played with, and that's my claim to fame. I just moved him a new house today.
Smithsonian Institute presented in Washington a kind of a convention, a conclave of folk music. And they contacted Dobber Johnson, original fiddle player on Louisiana Hayride, one of the original fiddle players, certainly the original in our staff band. And Dobber got together some of the guys off the Hayride, and they went up and they worked in Washington for 2 weeks. They were not allowed any amplified instruments. We're going to use some here so you can hear them. They're going to do you two or three songs. Then we're going to get Nat Stuckey back before the night's over. And this is a type of music. This is called American folk music, North Louisiana folk music, right? Dobber Johnson. Now we got three guys that haven't been introduced. Now I want you to introduce them all, Dobber, because we were saving them to last.
Okay. You want me to introduce them?
Absolutely.
Okay, good enough. This is Bill Kirkpatrick on guitar. This is Mike Kirkpatrick. This is Bill Kirkpatrick's son. He plays guitar. On the bass fiddle. We've got Lum York. He started over with Hank Williams in Alabama when he first started singing. Came to Shreveport with him. He now lives in Baton Rouge, and that's how he got to Louisiana. Lum York. Let's give him a big hand. Over on the other guitar, he also plays fiddle. He's going to do you a fiddle tune right after we do this first number. It's Bill Kirkpatrick, and Bill is a state champion fiddler, mighty good fiddler, and he writes songs too, a lot of fiddle tunes. So we're going to start off with one. Well, I would like to tell you that while we were in Washington, we were fortunate enough for Voice America to broadcast us over to China. I don't know if they understood what we were doing or not, but anyway, they did. And we were also on the Armed Services Network all over the world. And they showed some film clips of us on July the 4th when Good Morning America was broadcasting from the National Folklife Festival grounds. So I don't know if any of you saw it or not, but we're real proud of the fact that some country folks from North Louisiana was invited up to Washington to do our type of music. Here we go now with the guitar poke.
Sold out with my mom, told the mama many charms.
Cliff Morrison was going to accept us. We were up there 2 weeks and we played two shows a day. But after the first couple of shows, we had standing room only crowds, and folks would get up and dance while we was playing, clap their hands and everything, and they just took to it just like ducks to water. It really surprised us. They liked it.
Yeah, we had more fun up there, and a bucket of ace poured out in a gallon of sorghum syrup, didn't we? Hey, you know what? I want to tell them about that dream I had last night. Well, I had a bad dream. I dreamed that Boy George was my older brother, and I had to wear hand-me-downs. No, I did. I had a pretty dream. I had a good dream, though. After that, I dreamed that I was a baby again, and Dolly Parton was my mama.
Gotta watch old Lum. He's liable to say anything. We're gonna do another we did up there. Took a good reception to. One you don't hear too much called Listen to the Mockingbird.
Louisiana Hayride Hall of Fame. It would not diminish the use of the auditorium at all. In fact, if you were a country fan and you were driving on the highway and you saw a sign that says, see the building where Elvis Presley became famous, Johnny Cash became famous, Jim Reeves, George Jones, Hank Williams, you'd stop and look at it, wouldn't you? You sure would. It would help upkeep the old building, and it is a great old building. It was built in the early 20s as a memorial to World War I veterans. Structurally, it's sound. It does need some rewiring and such, but I think it should be preserved because it is a unique and unusual building. I propose that in April of 1988, which will be the 40th anniversary of the starting of the Louisiana Hayride, that we have down on these grounds right here a festival of this type, and that I invite back to meet with you every single person still living who was ever on the Louisiana Hayride. Yeah. Program about the cradle of the stars. It ended up with Floyd Kramer saying, wouldn't it be great if we could just get together one more time? I think it would. I'm going to do the best I can, and when I holler for you to push the price, push the city council a little bit, and the mayor, push them a little bit, because we'll get it done, won't we? Yes, we will.
Hey, Horace?
Yes.
We've got one fellow that had a lot to do with the hayride and managed a lot of the artists there to start them.
Yes.
That's not here tonight. I don't know where he is. Him and David's out picking somewhere, I guess, but that's Tillman Frank.
Tillman Frank.
Tillman, wherever you are, we miss you, boy.
Yes. Okay, we're going to get the gang back up here on stage, get Nat Stuckey back and James Burton and the bunch, and we're going to wind it up in a few minutes. They're going to have some fireworks, I understand it, very shortly, about the time we get through. So let's get them all back on stage here again. Got Don Davis back here and the others.
Oh, they get scattered. They are round up.
They are. That comes Felton Pruett. Ah, oh, Pruett. There comes DJ Fontana, yes. Friends, that's a cup of water he's carrying in his left hand there. Everybody believe that, stand up. Not a soul got up there, huh? We already know what it is in that cup that Nat's got, yes. He done told us. Okay. Here once again, entertainer, part of the original Louisiana Hayride band, and Nat Stuckey himself.
Thank you very much. We've given credit to a lot of people tonight. People who are former performers on the Louisiana Hayride and the people associated with the Hayride. I would like to express my appreciation, and I know I speak for everybody else up here on stage and everybody as far as the talent is concerned. The ladies who have been responsible for getting us to the proper place at the proper time and providing the food and drinks and everything, I would like to say a big thank you to those folks. Libby, are you there? We do appreciate you. Because these are the people that don't get a heck of a lot of publicity, but they do an awful lot of work. And we were having a bite to eat over here before the show tonight, and somebody asked me if I knew any Hank Williams songs. And I hope he'll forgive me, but I do. Thank you.
Tennessee, the spirit is on the south side. I am only
was out where the bright lights are glowing. You're drawn by the light to a flame, and you laugh while the wine is over. Things about coming back to get together with some of the guys from the Louisiana Hayride is having the opportunity to get together with some of you old fans of the Louisiana Hayride. We love every one of you. It's so happy to see you, so nice to see you. A lot of our artists are not with us. They've passed on. We'd like to pay a little time of tribute to them for just a minute. Jack Anglin, Doyle Wilbon, Red Sovine, Elvis Presley, Hank Williams, Jonny Horton, Bob Lumen, T. Texas Tyler, Moon Mullican, Jim Reeves, Harmy Smith, Zeke Clements, Happy Covington, Lefty Frizzell, Buddy Attaway, Paul Howard, and Texas Ruby. I think they're watching tonight, and I think they like the idea of a Country Music Hall of Fame. I think we're going to try to do it. We do thank you so much for coming out. We hope you enjoyed this old get-together reunion of a few of the people from Louisiana Hayride as much as we enjoyed being here. And good night, everybody. God bless you all.